Oh, yeah. What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to the Tayler Yarish Show, everybody. This is, if you don't know, this is the podcast that I do. This is the podcast that I do where it's just me, and I talk to you, and you listen, maybe. Maybe you listen, maybe you don't. And I don't know. I don't know if you're listening, but if you are, then you are. You know what I mean? Okay. What a nice time of the year it is. This is my favorite time of the year. This is like my birthday was a couple, it was like a week or so ago or whatever. And I'm very proud, even though I didn't do anything. I like the fact that my birthday is in a nice weather time of the year. Everyone's enjoying themselves because it's nice out, you know? And, I don't know. I feel a little responsible for that, for some reason. Like, yeah, it's also my birthday, so, you know, you're welcome. You're welcome for the nice weather. It is the best, it's the best weather. It's cool, it's like low 70s, there's no humidity, and you feel good wearing long sleeves, you know? You can just wear, like, a long sleeve shirt, and you don't have to, like, show your arms or whatever. And, because most arms are gross. Most arms should not be like the tricep. Most people's tricep arms area is really gross. You can't really look after that part of your body either. There's no, you know, besides lotion, there's not much we can do. You have so many serums and creams and clays and masks and gels and spritzes that you put on your face, but there's nothing like the rest of the body. You just get lotion. I don't know. I know the face is sensitive or whatever, but like, you know, you got nothing for the back of your arms. And, I don't know. Are there some rules that we should be doing for the rest of our body that we focus too much on the face? Should we be exfoliating our arms more? I don't exfoliate my arms. Some people, this is mainly with fat people I notice, where like they have these, the skin in certain areas of the body, it's like at the base of like the hair follicle, it's like red, you know? And I don't know what that is. I had this buddy in high school who I did theater with, and he was a fat guy. And it was always funny when he wore shorts, because his shorts, like, they fit him in the waist, but I don't know why. He had these shorts that, like, kind of, they seemed like they tapered a little bit, and so his thighs, like, his waist fit in his shorts, but his thighs didn't fit in his shorts. So there was, like, this clear bottleneck thing that was happening where his thighs were being constricted, and then it was even worse when he sat down, you know, because, like, then it spreads out and it stretches and everything, and it was really looked uncomfortable. But anyway, he had the top of his thighs, his hairs, he had like these red dots, you know, at the base of his hairs. And it probably wasn't good. It probably means it was like inflammation, but you don't know. But it's like nobody looks into that. It's like on the top of your thigh, so nobody cares. Nobody's like, oh, if those red bumps were at the base of the hair follicles that are on your face, you'd be like, I have a disease. I have a serious problem that needs to be addressed now. Make the dermatologist appointment now. But it's just the top of your thigh, so no one cares. I probably got some stuff. I got a bump on my back right now. I don't know if it's a bug. It's like right on my spine. It's a red bump. It looks like a pimple, and it feels like a pimple slash bug bite, and I'm just not concerned about it. It only hurts when I touch it, but I don't see it, so I don't do anything about it. But if it was on my face, I'd be in a full panic. It's kind of crazy. It's still my body. Everyone's, you know, a lot more vain than we claim to be. I don't care what's on my back. I just, like, the other day realized that, like, I have more back hair than I thought I did. You know, I looked at my back in a mirror once, like, ah, fuck. thing on my end with the headphones. I looked at my back once, like 4 years ago in a mirror. And then that was just the image that I had in my head of what my back looked like. You know, I didn't feel like a need to update that. You know, when you're on your computer, if you have like a backup hard drive or whatever, like you use it once and then it'll remind you every like 30 days, like, hey, you haven't backed this up in like 30 days. But it was like 4 years for the image of my back. My mental hard drive was not backed up for 4 years when it comes to the image of my back. That's what I'm saying. And so when I looked at it, it just like fast forwarded time. And those are always weird moments, you know, when you think of something and you have an image in your head and then you see the thing in real time and you're like, whoa, you know, that's basically all a high school reunion is, by the way. It's people that you haven't seen since high school. And then you're like, ah, what happened? You know, everyone looks sick. Everyone's just got more bags under their eyes. Their hair's a little worse. You know, they probably gained a little weight and they got red circles at the base of their hair follicles and their skin. If they got a lot fatter, or maybe not, you know, there's some bigger people that have beautiful skin all over. So maybe it's just people. I don't know what they're doing. We should ask them. We should ask them what they're doing to keep their skin great. You know, it's probably just a lotion thing. It's probably a lotion and an exfoliant thing. Cause I clean the top of my thighs. I do. I don't care about the top of my thighs in terms of like appearance or just really even like from a hygiene standpoint. Like I've never like, oh, the top of my thighs smell. That's never been a thought. And yet for some reason, when I get into a shower, I put the soap, you know, the Aveeno or whatever. I get a couple pumps, move it in my hands a little bit, and then the first thing I start to do is I rub my thighs. Does anyone else do this? Have I mentioned this before? I don't know. But that's like the first place that I start to rub. I start to rub my thighs, and then I'll rub my ass cheeks, and then I'll hit like my armpits. These are my armpits. These are my armpits. But that's the third thing that I hit. And it's, you know, probably the most smelliest part besides my asshole, of course. Yeah, I hit my asshole like last. You should want the most concentrated amount of soap to hit the worst spot first. And I don't. It's like the last thing. Sometimes, you know, you might forget. No, that's not true. I don't forget. But it is like towards the end. I hit other places first. And then I'm like, oh yeah, I should definitely wash that part. But the thighs get the first. Maybe that's just because that's where my hands fall. You know? So I have the soap in my hands and then they just, because of gravity, the hands wanna go down. And they naturally lay by my thighs. So that's where my brain just start rubbing. That's the instructions. That's how you clean yourself. You get soapy hands and then just start touching yourself. How do I clean? Take this bar of soap and just start touching yourself. That's really it when you think about it. But when you think, you know, if somebody told me to start touching myself, I'd probably, you know, those are the places that I would touch. I would touch my legs and then my butt and my chest and stuff. I wouldn't go straight for my asshole. So maybe in my subconscious, deep down, there's some connection between cleaning myself and also rubbing myself in a sensual way. Where it's like, all right, it's time to get clean. And I just start going to town, you know? Oh, I don't know. I don't know how we got down this road. I think I was talking about the weather. Oh, yeah, that's good. Man, I had work today, and this person that I work with, they go to poetry competitions. That's like their thing that they do. They go to poetry competitions. I don't know how you judge poetry. Isn't the whole part of it that it can't be, you shouldn't judge it? I don't want to say it's a dumb art. It's dumb. There's a time in my life I've tried to, you know, I did it once in college and then I didn't do it because I'm like, I don't like this. And I don't know if it's always been like this, but like some poetry, at least nowadays, especially slam poetry, which like, hey, you're taking yourself way too seriously. This is slam poetry. Get ready to be slammed by my similes. Bro, we're gonna fucking rock the house with this imagery in my poem. Poems at slam poet like things, what they turn into is just like trauma grief porn. It's like a poem. The ones that get the most snaps, which is what you do instead of clapping for some reason. I don't really know why. Like a clap is just too disruptive or something. And so you're not gonna win the competition if you have a poem, you know, if you have a poem about lawn chairs or something like that. Just something innocuous. You know, you like daisies. I'm going to write a poem about daisies. No, you can't do it. No, it's got to be about how your uncle touched you and your family's never been the same and how it's changed your entire upbringing and how you mourn the loss of the person that you could have been, but it was stolen from you at such an age where you didn't even have any control. And now you look in the mirror and you struggle with control with the person that you see because you don't identify with them anymore or never did. That's what you got to talk about to win a slam poet contest. And it doesn't sound healthy. Like, why would you want to have like a career in that where you're just constantly trying to think up the worst, saddest shit ever to talk about, to get a couple of snaps at a ribbon, you know, at some contest inside of a Hilton, you know, gallery thing that somebody rented out in the middle of Wisconsin or whatever. It just doesn't seem worth it. You know? I don't connect with here's what I think when it comes to like poetry. I think I like things that are really poetic. I appreciate something that's super poetic, except poetry. Does that make any sense? Like, I love a nice poetic death, you know? Like a Romeo and Juliet, like a poetic death, or like Tom Hanks in Saving Private Ryan, you know? He risked it all and sacrificed so much and died to save a man that he never even met. That's a poetic death. But like The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe? Fuck off. I just don't, it's not interesting to me. There's nothing else for me. You can't just have the things on a page. It's not good enough in this day and age. You can't just compare, you know, staring into the closet as, you know, it's the black hole of a thing. You can't just lead in with a good analogy and have it suffice anymore. There's got to be something else to it. I like poetic nature of things. I just don't like poems. Kendrick Lamar, super poetic rapper, you know? But I could play his music in the car and to have it be on in the background, or I can sit down. I can really listen and hear the words with the music and how he kind of puts the whole thing together. It's beautiful. It's poetic. But, you know, I don't want to hear Maya Angelou read. Is that wrong? Because I don't think people, like, and I think I'm not alone on this. Because Kendrick Lamar is very popular. Maya Angelou's popular, but if they both did a tour, who's selling out the garden? It's probably Kendrick Lamar. You know? I like a poetic death. That's like probably where you're just like, that's poetic. Shakespearean shit had a lot of poetic deaths. You know what's funny is that poetry is a dying art form. And I think it's funny that the death of poetry is really not poetic at all. People just kind of are not interested in it. That's the death. That's the whole death of poetry. Is that, people aren't interested. We're just going to do something else with our time, I think. Yeah. Oh, you have a poetry thing next Saturday? Yeah, I don't think I'm going to go to that. That's the death. That's the death that poetry gets. You know, because that's what it is. But, I don't want to shit on anyone's art form. But I've heard poets have that thing. I have a friend who's now a musician who has very poetic music. He said the same thing. He's like, poetry, it ends up turning into its grief porn. And maybe it doesn't have to be. But the genre of poetry that I feel like exists nowadays, because if you just write poems and haikus and shit about random, you're not going to get people to care nowadays. It's just not an art form that's really appreciated, you know? Maybe by a very niche, hipstery subset of a small population, you know? People don't appreciate the poetry. It's just outdated. It's like the loom. Nobody uses that. You know what I mean? You guys are on board, right? None of these people that listen to this like poetry, you know? But I like a good poetic death. You can have a poem. Maybe have a poem written on your tombstone. That'd be fun. I'd like a poem. Nah. What would you choose? I don't even know, you gotta have something written on your tombstone? What a lot of pressure. You know what's crazy is, that seems like pressure, but when we went down to, I think we were in Mexico, it was either Mexico or Jamaica. I don't like travel a lot. It's the only two times I've traveled. But I think it was Mexico. We visited this gravesite, and all the gravestones, they didn't have, words written on them. They had photographs. All the graves had photographs of the, not like a sketch, or it was a photograph attached to the tombstone. It was, encased or whatever, so it would remain intact. And there were just photos of the people, taken at some point in their life. And I thought, wow, that is a lot of pressure to put on one photo. You know what I mean? Do you get to choose that what the photo is going to be before you die? Because if not, that's a nightmare. I wouldn't want to leave that to somebody else. Yeah, I'm going to let you just decide what I look like. You know, you're kind of just determining once and for all what, you know, when people think of me, what is the image? This is the picture. Would you even let somebody post a picture of you to your social media without you seeing it first? It's not a chance in hell. So the pressure to pick a photograph to represent you on your tombstone that's going to be there forever? Oh my God. Does a photo even exist that could qualify? What shirt are you picking? What shirt are you picking for eternity? Because I have, you know, I may have a favorite shirt or a shirt that's most comfortable that I want to wear, you know, that I wear a lot. We kind of all have the same, you know, you look in the laundry each time and it's kind of the same recurring shirts. But I don't know if I could pick one for forever, you know? Do you think they, like, try to prep for the photo? Like, oh, you know, we got the death shoot coming up in 6 weeks, so I'm really trying to crank it out in the gym. No dessert for me. I'm shooting my tombstone pic next week. Trying to cut down. I've been a little bloated. I've gone heavy on the carbs these past few weeks, so I don't want to look like shit forever when I die. I would imagine that you would want to pick your own photo. Because that's a lot of response. It's almost more responsibility to have somebody pick that photo than it is to, you know, than it is to have, like, the executor who arranges your whole funeral. Because I've had that position, and it's a shit ton of work. But, you know, if you fuck up, it's not the end of the world. Things will move on. But, like, to choose one photograph for somebody, where any time somebody, you know, goes to their tomb or their, you know, their grave, and they see the picture of them, that's the picture. That's a lot to put on someone. Think anyone ever gets up to heaven and they look back down? They're like, that's the fucking photo that you went with? That one? Dude, I was hungover in that picture. We were at brunch. I was like three fucking Bloody Marys deep. Why did you pick that? Look at the double chin that I'm rocking right now. That's how, I don't even remember that photo. That's how hammered I was. Would you, you chose that one because the sun was hitting my face from the right angle? Look at my double chin. You asshole. It almost makes your whole life worthless. Like, you could, you could work out your whole, like, what if you worked out your whole life? You're, like, shredded, you know? You're a fitness trainer. You played sports in high school. You just cut, you know, 10%, 5% body fat, just something insane your whole life. And then, you know what? You get old and you decide you're going to let it go. You start to let it go when you hit middle age and, you know, you're 40s and 50s and 60s or whatever. You're just like, you just get fat as fuck. And then you die, and then that's the photo that they put on your grave. You're like, man, that's not me. Come on, man. Like, just some huge fat guy who's got bodybuilding medals around his tomb. It was bananas, you know? It's kind of creepy. It made it more, like, seeing all the photographs, it made it feel more like, oh, there's bodies under here. Like, you walk through a grave, you know, a gravesite or graveyard. Yeah, that's the word. Like, you walk through a graveyard, you don't totally get the sense that, like, hey, we're walking over a bunch of dead bodies. But when there's, like, pictures, like, pictures of people on there, and it's, like, a picture, like, from their life, you know, they're, like, sitting at the kitchen counter or whatever, it's kind of creepy. You're like, oh, they're right down there. Ooh. You, like, want to whisper, like, oh, I hope they don't hear me. They're right under there. And there's, like, 1,000 of them. You're like, whoa, there's, like, 1,000 dead bodies down here. It's so bananas. It kind of makes it feel like they died in a tragic way. Like, you know, like, whatever the picture is, that's when they died, you know? Like, oh, this is them at the poker tournament that we play every year at the family reunion. And then they died shortly after this photo was taken. That's, like, it's honestly, it's kind of the feel. of it. But I don't know. They seem to think of it differently down there. Like, it's a natural, it's a normal thing to, like, go. I think we went on a Sunday, which is, like, a big day where people will go and they'll just visit the gravesite. They make a fucking day out of it. They, like, have a picnic. They get a bunch of shit. The whole place is just littered with Coronas, you know, just buckets of Coronas. And actually, not Coronas, Modelos. That's what they drink. And so they bring a bunch of Modelos. They'll fucking cook food. And they all just, like, cook around the grave. And it was kind of nice. It was weirdly poetic. I don't know why it was poetic, but that was the feeling. The feeling was, man, this is beautifully poetic. This person had a life, and then there was a reverence. They died. There was sadness, but then it gets to come back up again, and they come back and they see this sight, and it reminds them of the good times, and then ironically, it brings the family together for a nice, happy moment. That's beautiful. That's poetic. But, like, if any point during that gathering, somebody, like, pulled out a poem and started reading it, it'd be a fucking bummer. You'd be like, dude, you're ruining this person's death time. This is not, how dare you disgrace this person's, the afterlife of this person by standing over their grave and reading poetry. Ugh. Does anyone even like it when they do that at the funeral? A time to live and a time to die. A time to heal and a time to speak. And a time to walk and a time to run. It's a time to sit and a time to stand. It's whatever that, what is that fucking stupid thing that people read? Is it a time to live and a time to die? No. What is it? Turn? Yeah. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. Hey, you could do that forever! What a lazy, lazy poem that everybody... It's a song by the Byrds. Hey, you know what? Boo! Boo! You dumb Byrds. What a stupid band name. Hey, man, we're here to sign up for the open mic. We're going to play a couple of songs. Okay, what's your name? What's your name?
Oh, I'm Johnny, and it's Rick or whatever. And we're the Byrds.
Oh, that's so funny. What's your name?
Oh, we're...
It's like the first time that he's like saying it out loud. You know, they all had the, like, in public. they were like so high when they thought of the name. They thought it was so cool. What's your name, guys?
Oh, are you ready? We're the Byrds.
Oh, what a dumb fucking name. Oh man, I don't know any other song that they do. Oh, look at this picture of them. They're from the era where everyone just stood up straight and played the guitar with just no, there's just no feeling in their joints. They didn't move at all, and they just stood there and strummed. Oh man, what does this actually sound like? Wait, fuck, can you hear it? Oh, no, fuck me. Oh, it's not connected. God damn it. Oh, there we go. I don't want to get, like, copyrighted or whatever. Yeah. Yeah, no, you fucking Beatles wannabe. That's what that sounded like.
The time to heal, the time to heal. Oh, 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 oh.
Yeah, we're the Byrds. man, why does everyone read that at a funeral? It's kind of a, it, and like, when do you, it's a long song too. When do you stop? Eventually. That's always the best part. That's like the best moment of a funeral. Because a funeral is obviously so fucking sad, right? But I feel like there's a moment in every funeral where, you know, it's not, it's an unspoken feeling where everybody in the audience, like there's somebody up talking and they're kind of like bombing, you know what I mean? They're kind of talking and, you know, the audience couldn't be more receptive for what you're... It's like, it's the same thing with like a wedding. Like, everybody's rooting for you to say the right, you know, thing and to go up and do a good, you know, tribute or whatever. And some people just bomb tributes, you know? And it's so awful to be like, this is the worst day of my life. I couldn't be more sad. I'm so sad. And yet... you're bombing up there so hard that my uncomfortableness for what's coming out of your fucking mouth is overriding the sadness that I have over the death of someone. Can you imagine? Is that, am I the only one that's experienced that? Where you're like, this is so tragic and horrible, but... It would be better if you stopped speaking. Oh, man. Oh, Jesus. This flew by, huh? I had fun. That's the podcast this week, everybody. Enjoy your Monday. I hope if you're listening to this on Monday, otherwise enjoy whatever day it is. Yeah, that's the podcast this week. If you're in New York, we have a show at Terra Rose Bar this Wednesday, the 22nd, at 7:30. Doors are at 7 o'clock. Just fucking message me if you want to come. I'll get you free tickets. Just come on out. We got Roy Wood Jr. on the show. You heard that right. We got fucking Roy Wood Jr. from The Daily Show, HBO, Comedy Central, you fucking name it. He's absolutely hysterical, and... yeah, you should come. That's it. Have a good one. We'll see you next week. Peace.